We have been looking at some qualities about God that expand our view of Him and actually help us in our lives. We've already seen that God is great, so I don't have to be in control. God is glorious, so I don't have to be afraid of anyone. And today we're going to look at the fact that God is good, so I don't have to find satisfaction elsewhere. So let me ask you a question. How do you handle stress? How do you cope? Obviously, during this time now, this is one of those moments where we are thinking about and wondering about our coping and how do we handle this. This is a crisis. So now there is obviously unhealthy ways that people cope. You know, drugs and alcohol, we know that they're not good. But then there's healthy ways. You know, we're working out, we're breathing exercises, maybe we go on vacation or for a walk. But what happens when those healthy coping habits become unhealthy? See, we're great at taking something that's good, that's innocent, and then blowing it up and making it unhealthy. I mean, look what we do with food. I mean, food, it's good, it's great, there's wonderful things about food, but we become gluttons. And we don't do anything in moderation, so we have to have not just a handful of chips, we have to have the whole bag. Not that we have one cookie, we've got to have 12 cookies. Or alcohol, and then we have alcohol problems. And then we want to involve ourselves and work hard, but we become workaholics. Or we want to get exercise and become gymaholics, or germaphobes that we're afraid of everything. Or that beautiful gift of sex that we often pervert. We misuse prescription drugs, and we could go on and on and on. It's fascinating that in the life of Israel in the Old Testament, you find over and over how they turn to other things other than the true God to meet their needs. And so one of the prophets, he gives the picture that I think captures what we often do with our coping mechanisms, the good things in life that we may go to for pleasure. For example, Jeremiah says in chapter 2, verse 13, he says, "For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and made cisterns for themselves, broken cisterns that can hold no water." So get the picture. There's two things that they're doing wrong. They're turning away from the fountain that really provides what they need, and instead they're turning to something else that offers what they need, but really leaks away. So cisterns were used like a reservoir. It's like the water tank of the community. So what he's saying is, I'm offering you a fountain that's always going to be flowing, but you instead build these tanks that have cracks in them. And so you fill them with water, and what happens? They go out. Or you fill them with water, and dirt gets in, and it's ugly water. You know, the foundation to the lie that Adam and Eve bought into was the belief that God is not good. He must be withholding something. Remember the serpent saying, "Oh, God just wants you to, you know, you're not surely going to die. God just doesn't want you to be like Him. He's holding back the truth that you can be like Him. He's keeping it all to Himself." So from the very start of our journey as human beings, we felt like we had to provide for ourselves. We have to take care of ourselves. It's very much the spirit that the United States of America was founded on. This independent, self-reliant, we can take care of ourselves mentality. Now that might be good for surviving in the Wild West. But when it comes to our souls, it only leads to a parched desert. Adam and Eve believed that lie. Israel believed that lie. We believe that lie. And every time we do, we end up having temporary satisfaction that's quickly followed by deep dissatisfaction or emptiness or shame or even guilt. And our souls remain unfulfilled. There was an incident in the life of Jesus. You might remember it. He's walking with his disciples, and they're off trying to find food. And Jesus comes to a well where there's a woman. And the woman happens to be a Samaritan woman. She's one of the extensions of Judah, mixed breed of the Jews. And so they're not really supposed to socialize together. And Jesus sees her as she comes to draw water from the well. And he says to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples have been off buying the food. She wasn't, no one else was there to serve him. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask me for a drink, a woman of Samaria?" And Jesus says, "Well, if you knew the gift of God and who is it that's saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would give you living water." And the woman says to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with and the well is deep. How are you going to get at living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well that we can drink from?" And Jesus says to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water," pointing to this earthly practical well, "will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I give will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of living water that's overflowing." Sounds like Jeremiah. And so the woman says, "Give me this water that I'm going to have to be thirsty." And so Jesus then says to her, "Go and get your husband and come here." And she says, "Well, I have no husband." And Jesus says, "Yeah, you're right. For you have had five husbands, and the one that you have now is not your husband." And so the woman says, "Oh, you must be a prophet." Obviously, this woman had many men. It's almost as though, let's just assume for a moment, that she was going from man to man to man to find relief for her soul, to be fed, to be given, having that thirst for relationship and for love satisfied. But it was going unfulfilled because the tanks were cracked, the cisterns were broken. You know, oftentimes our coping mechanisms end up morphing into idols, and those little gods are insatiable and they're demanding of our service to them. And oftentimes it takes a crisis for that to be shown to us, for their limits to be exposed. I remember years ago, I was going through a crisis with stress and anxiety, and one of the ways that I would handle anxiety was food. I enjoy eating, so I would have food, or I'd watch some television programs, or play sports, or maybe be intimate with my wife. And some of those things were, which in and of themselves, there's nothing wrong about. But when they were taken away from me, because I had something wrong where I couldn't have garlic, tomato, onions, or chocolate. I mean, those garlic, tomato, and onions is like the holy trinity of Italian cooking. So without that, well, what am I going to eat? How am I going to have that part of me met? I can't use food now. I would watch television programs, but the shows that I liked were causing me more anxiety because they were stressful and tense. I couldn't watch those. It was the winter. I couldn't play sports. And so all the things that I would use were failing to meet my need. See, Jesus came to satisfy our hunger. And he said that those who hunger and thirst for righteousness would be fulfilled. And so if we connect with him, then our souls will have rest. And he would place within us a spring of living water. He would be the bread of life that satisfies our hunger. And he would dwell with us through his Holy Spirit and never leave us. C.S. Lewis wrote, "We are half-hearted creatures, fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea, we are far too easily pleased." We are really far too easily pleased with lesser things. The psalmist calls upon us, he says, "Come, come and taste that the Lord is good." How do we do that? Is he good only when he does the things that we think he needs to be done? Is he good only when life is comfortable and convenient? Is he good only when our circumstances around us seem fair or reputable or equitable or good? But God's goodness is not situational. Instead, in order to experience God's goodness, it is actually linked to experience his presence. Moses wanted desperately to see God's face, and I would want to desperately to see God's face. Please show yourself to me right here, right now. But God said to Moses, "No, I can't let you see my face because you can't deal with it. You'll die, but I'll show you my back." And then he said this, "When my goodness passes by you." Oh, God's goodness is experienced in God's presence, because God equates his goodness with his presence. So the more time I spend in God's presence, the more I will know his goodness. Or going back to what Jesus said to the woman at the well, the more we spend with Jesus, the more he gives water to our souls. He quenches our thirst. So here we are. The corona apocalypse is upon us, a crisis. There is a lot we can't even turn to anymore. So what's going to be your satisfaction? What's going to meet your needs? What's going to calm your heart? Being with family? Certain foods? Alcohol? It's available everywhere. It's one thing that's not missing from stores. Maybe drugs? Sleep? Binge watching? Video games? Or maybe simply spending time with Jesus because you've slowed down and have to pause. To talk to him. To listen to the truths of Scripture. To worship to music. To look for him in every conversation, in every person, in every post. God is good, so we don't have to find satisfaction elsewhere. Come. Come and taste, not just see, not hear, not touch, but taste that the Lord is good. Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters that they would experience your presence above everything else during this time. As they may be even alone at home, that you would visit them. As they are with family, that you would visit them. Lord, that they would sense your presence, hear your passion for them as people, and they would connect with you at a level that they don't ever connect with even by coming to a church building. So visit with your people, Lord. I know this is your desire. You want to be with your people. Visit with every one of the members and parts of the family of Gospel Alliance, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless everybody.